So resurrection morning, and an opportunity for us to once again step back and cover ground that we're all very familiar with, right? And at the same time, it's ground that we are drawn back to again and again like a moth to flame. We are drawn back to the resurrection. We are drawn back to the events of this morning that we celebrate today. Someone says, Kevin, the resurrection is true every day of our lives. Absolutely it is. But how special it is to take time and be reminded every year in a significant way. This is why God built the celebrations into the Jewish calendar, because we as people need to be reminded. We need to be reminded. This is the reminder for us today of the significance that we serve a risen Savior. I know it's true every day, but what a great opportunity to get to share it together as we gather. So, He is risen. The Lord is risen. Yes, He's risen indeed. Today, we are going to be looking at a passage that I'm going to tell you. It's actually the last one in a series that I was doing recently. You guys know I did a series this fall and winter on one-on-one with Jesus. One-on-one episodes where people had an opportunity to speak face-to-face, one-on-one with the creator of all the world, Jesus. When he was on earth, as he became man in the incarnation and also God, but as he walked this earth for the time he was here, there were people who got to interact with, they got to speak face-to-face with their creator. And so that series was all about one-on-one encounters with Jesus. And I actually saved one for today. I saved one for today because I said, that's just too good to not share on that morning. I'd like for you to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of John chapter 20. The Gospel of John chapter 20. And we're going to read this and see if you can find the one-on-one encounter as I read. John's Gospel, chapter 20, and we're going to start at verse 1. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. So she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter and the other disciple went forth, and they were going to the tomb. The two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first. And stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. And so Simon Peter also came following him and entered the tomb, and he saw the linen wrappings lying there and the face cloth which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So the other disciple who had first come to the tomb then also entered, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So the disciples went away again to their own homes. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping. And so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had been lying. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they've laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father, and my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came, announcing to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. That's where we stop today. Let's have a word of prayer again. Our God, we thank you for your word. It is your truth, eternal across all ages. And we thank you that it speaks to us as we need its truth today. Oh, Lord, We pray, as we do every week, that you would open our hearts, our minds, our lives to you. Give us ears to hear, Jesus, that we would be changed as we come to your eternal truth. And we ask it in your name and for your glory. Amen. Mary. Mary at the tomb. We start there in verse 1. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb. Mary Magdalene is one of the Marys, and there are about a half dozen or more in the gospel records, different Marys, of course, Mary, the mother of Jesus, and other ones as well. But Mary Magdalene has got an interesting history in that we're told in the Gospel of Luke and also in the Gospel of Mark as well. Soon afterwards, he, Jesus, began going around from one city and village to another, proclaiming and preaching the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, who was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out. And then he goes on to list other women as well. When Jesus was doing his ministry on earth, besides the disciples, there were some women that went along to help with the various odds and ends that had to be done, and I'm sure arranging provisions and all sorts of things, and one of those is Mary Magdalene. Magdalene is not a last name, by the way. It actually, it has to do with the place she's from, Magdala, which was a town on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. It was a town that was a town of ill repute. One of the Jewish rabbis had written that it was a town ridden with prostitution. And so sometimes you hear that charge against Mary Magdalene. We don't know that. It's not in the scripture. But we do know this. In that day, people could be so troubled and so given over and so far from the Lord that demons could come and actually indwell their body. By the way, that's not just in that day. It can still happen today. We have other names for it perhaps today, and maybe we're so scientific, but this is what's happening. There is a demonic spirit that's working in those situations, and here Mary has 7 demons. The actual way it reads is she had 7 demons. 7 demons had gone out from her. Think about that, the deliverance that Jesus had brought about for her, and then you know why it is that she is there on the first day of the week. This is the day after Sabbath. They're not allowed to go and do this work on the Sabbath. It's not Mary alone, by the way. We're told in the other Gospels that some other women have gone along as well. They're bringing some various spices to properly entomb the body. And you say, well, I thought that was done by Joseph of Arimathea. How many times have you seen that a man does something and then the woman says, oh, that's fine? So the women are like, you know, we know that you guys did, but we want to go and really set things the way they ought to be. That's really what's happening. They have, out of their love and their devotion to Christ, they are wanting to be sure that everything is done just exactly perfectly in their love and devotion to what they are thinking of their dead master. Yet as they come, we zero in to Mary Magdalene, and the event that happens here came early to the tomb while it was still dark and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. The tomb had a stone in front of it. Now, this could be sort of like a boulder in some instances, but we know that also it exists, and it sounds like here what you've seen is sort of the large stone disc that rolls in the track to go in front of the tomb. And the tomb, the opening of the tomb actually was low so that you had to stoop down to go in. And so that had to be taken out of the way to put the body in and then, of course, to close up the tomb. Well, when they came there, they see that the stone already was taken away from the tomb. We're told in verse 2, Mary comes to the instant conclusion, the grave is open, the stone has been moved. Somebody has done something here. So she ran and came to Simon Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved. This term about the disciple whom Jesus loved is a term that is only in the Gospel of John. It is the description that he uses of himself. He understands how much Jesus loves him. And I think that's such a very endearing term. Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved. By the way, why are Peter and John together at this point in time? If you read through the other gospel accounts at the cross, you find out that the only two disciples that are mentioned that go actually to the to see the crucifixion of Christ are Peter and John. The others all flee. Everybody flees, but Peter and John come back and hang around, and John actually is there right before the cross at the crucifixion. So Peter and John are by themselves, not around the other disciples. So Mary comes running to Simon and Peter, and she has this news. They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him. She jumps to that conclusion. Why else would the grave be open? They've taken his body. Now, this was something that was not unknown in that day, because we had back in 1878, this stone tablet, which is 2 feet tall, was found in the city of Nazareth. It actually was not discovered archaeologically there. It had been found somewhere else in the Holy Land and brought to the city of Nazareth, which at that time, in the late 1800s, had become sort of a place where archaeologists could go to find whatever sorts of things had been discovered. They would be brought there to be sold, because everyone in Israel at that time knew that that people would be coming to the birthplace of Jesus looking for these kind of things. Someone brought this tablet, and it was purchased by the curator of a museum in 1878. It's called the Nazareth Inscription. And what this is actually, it is an inscription, an edict of the Caesar of that day. It doesn't say which one. It just says at the top in Greek, Edict of Caesar. And this is an edict that is making a firm declaration about those who mess with graves. It says, it is my decision, says the emperor, concerning graves and tombs. Whoever has made them for the religious observances of parents or children or household members, that these remain undisturbed forever. And it, after some different descriptions of methodology, it comes up, it finishes with this final word. You are absolutely not to allow anyone to move those who have been entombed. But if someone does, I wish that violator to suffer capital punishment under the title of tomb breaker. In other words, this was something that had gone on in that day. People had stolen bodies from tombs, so that one of the Caesars had actually created an edict that it was capital punishment to do this. I just say that because you say, why would she think someone's taken the body? Because this is not unknown. They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him. So what are Peter and John going to do? They're going to go find out. So Peter and the other disciple went forth, and they were going to the tomb. And Peter is perhaps a little older, or John's just a little faster. The two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first. And stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. And so Simon Peter also came. Following him, he entered the tomb. That's just like Peter, isn't it? Peter's not going to hang back. He entered the tomb and saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the face cloth which he had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself, like it was done in an orderly fashion. And then the other disciple, John, who had first come to the tomb, then also entered. Once Peter had gone in, he felt, okay, I can come in too. So he goes in. And interesting, it says that he also entered, and he saw and believed. Now, when you read that, because we're so used to this in the New Testament, and they heard the gospel and they believed, we tend to think when we see this, oh, this is talking about somebody coming to faith. He believes that Jesus is raised from the dead. But actually, that's not what he believes, because the very next sentence, you caught this, says, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So when it says that John saw and believed, it can't mean that John saw and said, he's raised from the dead, because the very next verse says they didn't understand that yet. Well, what did he believe then? He believes what Mary had come and reported to them in the beginning of the episode. They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him. The belief that John comes to is someone has stolen the body. And that's why the very next thing that they do is John and Peter go away again to their own homes. Well, why would they go away to their own homes? Well, what are you going to do? You're going to go to the authorities? Are you going to go to the chief priest who had him crucified and say, we want to lodge a complaint, the body of Jesus is not there? No, you're not going to do that. Are you going to go to Pilate, the procurator who sentenced him to be crucified? So you're in a predicament here. The disciples say, oh, someone's stolen the body, but they can't have any sort of recourse to find out. So Peter and John just go home. But Mary, and this is so beautiful, this woman that is so devoted. And at this point, the other women, it seems, are gone. And now Mary, who's run to them and come back, now Mary is left there by herself at the tomb. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping. You think about this for her heart. Now not only has she lost her Lord to crucifixion, now even the body that she wanted to honor with proper burial preparation is gone, has been stolen. And she has no idea where to find it. And so she is weeping. You see her heart for the Lord. You see her love. And so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb, no doubt just wanting to see again to verify there is an empty place. And when she looks in, she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet where the body of Jesus had been lying. Now, I know that we tend to see this and think about that angels are going to have wings and they're going to have glowing garments. Not always, not necessarily. Sometimes they appear and look just like men. Many times in the scripture, people have no idea that this is an angel. They're dressed in white, but beyond that, she looks in and sees these two men sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying. And they spoke up and said to Mary, "Woman, why are you weeping?" You know, it's a very good question. You might remember when we preached on Doubting Thomas in this same series that I said that the problem with Thomas was not that he didn't believe the other disciples. He should have, but that wasn't the problem. The problem was he didn't believe the declared word of God, and he didn't believe the very words of Jesus. You see, again, here when the angels say to Mary, "Woman, why are you weeping?" That's a great question, because if you just go back to the Gospel of Matthew, three times here where Jesus declaring to them, from that time Jesus began to show his disciples he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised up on the third day. In Matthew 16, Jesus told the disciples, "I'm going to be raised on the third day." And in Matthew 17, Jesus told them, "And he will be raised, the Son of Man will be raised on the third day." And in Matthew 20, "And on the third day he will be raised up," speaking of himself. Jesus told the disciples again and again and again, "Yes, I'm going to be taken, I'm going to be arrested, I'm going to be crucified, but I will be raised on the third day." When Mary goes to the tomb, what day is it? It's the third day. This is Jewish reckoning. Each day is a day. It's the third day. Here they are, third day. And the tomb's open. Here she is distraught and weeping. And it's a fantastic question from the angels. "Woman, why are you weeping?" Mary's not putting this together yet, obviously. Nor would you or I. We wouldn't have either. Rather, she says to them, she explains the problem, "Because they've taken away my Lord and I do not know where they've laid him. They've taken the body." Now she's got someone to talk to and lodge a complaint. When she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. Ah, but she did not know that it was Jesus. It's interesting when you read commentators on this about why didn't she know it was Jesus. One person says, well, her eyes were so heavy with tears she couldn't recognize. Another says, it was still dark, she couldn't see. I think this could very well just be like on the road to Emmaus with the disciples. Jesus does not yet want to be seen by her. He doesn't yet want to be perceived. So he allows himself to be seen but not really seen, because there's an interaction that Jesus wants to have with her. This is the reason. See, when Jesus does these things, there's a purpose to it. Remember that. These one-on-one episodes, Jesus is working in unique ways to deal with unique situations in an individual heart. And so Jesus declaring to her, said to her, "Hey, woman, why are you weeping?" Didn't someone else just ask that? That's the same question the angels just asked. "Woman, why are you weeping?" Oh, she didn't get any satisfaction. "Well, they've taken the body of the Lord. I don't know where they put it." Here's Jesus. "Woman, why are you weeping?" And then Jesus adds this, "Whom are you seeking?" Now again, touching upon the heart of the matter. And it's so beautiful. Supposing him to be the gardener. It's probably the only time Jesus has ever been confused for a gardener. Supposing him to be the gardener. She said to him, and this is so, it's so beautiful, the love and the devotion and the adoration, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." Mary, how strong are you? Mary, frail Mary, who's here, racked with sorrow and pain. But in her loving devotion, she thinks, "I can do whatever needs to be done. If you will just show me where the body is, I will take him and carry him away. I'll take care of him." See, she thinks that the gardener has simply taken the body and moved it for whatever reason gardeners do. Oh, isn't it a beautiful, beautiful devotion to say that, to think, "I could do anything because of my love for him. I'll take care of the problem." And then verse 16. Jesus said to her. Now, stop there and think of all the things that Jesus could have rightfully said to her. He could have said, "Woman, why are you so thick-headed?" He could have said, "How long will it take for you guys to finally understand?" He could have said, "Lady, 3 times I told you I was going to come back from the dead. Can you not count?" I mean, there are many things he could have said. But what Jesus says to her is he says her name, Mary. And in that moment, Mary's whole world gets put back together. It's so beautiful. Mary. We're told in John chapter 10, verse 3, Jesus, speaking of himself as the good shepherd, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Jesus knows the name of his sheep, and it's so beautiful. When he wants to reveal himself to Mary, he doesn't say woman, or doesn't rebuke her or have some teaching. He just says her name, Mary. In Revelation chapter 1, Jesus will reveal himself in the revelation to John as Jesus in glory, the resurrected Jesus in glory, holy, awesome. John writes, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet like a dead man, and he placed his right hand on me, saying, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. And I was dead, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of Hades.'" And this is all true. This is the Jesus who is the resurrected Savior of all. He has conquered death, and he is presented like that. And let me tell you, he is the resurrected Lord of every believer on earth. Everyone who trusts in him, they gain the benefit that Jesus' resurrection, That is the final proof of the payment that it's part of, and you follow it through the New Testament, you see how important it is. It's part of the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection. Paul talks about it in 1 Corinthians 15. This resurrection, the resurrected power of Jesus is for all believers in all places at all times. And there's enough resurrection power, too, according to the Scripture, to take care of everybody, everyone, would they only turn to him. But know this. It's a great thing to me that Jesus is not only the glorious Savior, resurrected, declaring that to all in might and power, but I love that he's the resurrected Savior that looks at the individual and calls by name and says, Mary. And she turned to him in he and said to him, she turned and said to him in Hebrew, Rabboni. Now this is stated by John's gospel in Hebrew because John, when he wrote his gospel, was not writing just to the Jewish people like Matthew did. He is writing rather to the whole world. This is a letter or a gospel written to the whosoever that they might understand who Jesus is, that he's the Son of God, and that believing in him, they might have life in his name. So this is a gospel that's going to be targeting everybody. And because of that, he not only mentions, she said in Hebrew, Rabboni, but he also gives the translation teacher. This is actually a very intensive form of the word teacher. It's actually personal. It means my teacher, most literally, my teacher. And it was used as a title speaking not only as one who instructs, but in the sense of master, the one who I come to for all guidance, teacher, Rabboni. Only one of two places where it's used in the Gospels. And Mary declares this from her heart to Jesus. And I tell you, as her life had fallen apart, no doubt, at the crucifixion, this is where her life is put all back together. And look what happens. And so apparently, she grabs hold of Jesus and starts, what would you do? You would embrace him, absolutely. You would embrace him. Jesus says, stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Now, when he says, stop clinging to me, this is a really good translation of the word there. I know the King James says, do not touch me or touch me not. And it sounds like Jesus is going, no, don't touch me, don't touch me. But this is actually better understood here. It's a word that means to grasp or to hold. And Jesus, and I don't think Jesus does this right away. I don't think he's going like, woman, let go of me. I don't think it's that at all. If that were the case, he wouldn't have revealed himself. Why does he do this? What's this interaction about? Of course, what does she do when she sees it's Jesus? He reveals himself and says her name. And she says, Rabboni. You imagine you're not going to keep her away from jumping at him and grabbing and clutching and embracing. And what does she want to do? How long do you think Mary would have hung on to Jesus if she were allowed to? You think it would have been like a 10-second embrace? She would have said, okay, thanks, and walked away? No, how long would you have embraced Jesus if you saw him after the resurrection and your whole world was just restored? You know, she would have hung on to him, I believe, not for seconds or minutes. I think she would have hung on to him for hours. Understand this, that Jesus has a program for the ages. And there's a timetable, and this comes up not only in speaking with Mary, it comes up when he talks to the disciples and speaks about things that are going to come. It comes about in Acts chapter 1 when the disciples, even after the resurrection, as Jesus will appear to them over the next 40 days, the disciples are still asking, is it at this time that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Is this the time? Is this the time? And what does Jesus say? It's not for you to know the times that have been set by my Father's authority. See, God has a program, but we're not in the know about everything. Oh, I know, we want dates and we want charts, and some people will give those to you. But what God gives us is the instruction to look to him and cling to him. To, in faith, wait upon him and his and yes, he has all things ordered. When Jesus says, stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, he's saying, Mary, you're not going to get to hold me here because this is not the program. If you hold me here, then I can't be over there. I can't be with John and Peter right now if you're holding me here. Mary, there's going to be a time. And see, this is where you've got to see the future element. When Jesus says, I've not yet ascended to the Father, some have thought he's talking about he's got to go up and go through some kind of a ceremony or an ordeal in the heavenlies, and it's like he's sort of between stop one and stop two. I don't think that you've got to go into that kind of idea at all. I think all Jesus is saying to her is that I'm going to be with you for 40 more days, but the time for the real fellowship, the time for the real celebration, the time for the real clinging to me is going to be yet in the future. And it's going to be in two senses. One sense is, of course, in the distant future when he is ascended and we too are going to be there in that final resting place and we will be with him. That's the time. But there's also a declaration he makes about an intimacy that we're going to have as well through his Spirit. Notice, we'll see a little more on that, but notice, he tells Mary, but go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father and my God and your God. Now, another thing he's saying again, he talks about the ascension. And somebody reads that and says, well, it sounds like he's just about to do it now. When Jesus, after the resurrection, speaks like this, he doesn't mean instantly. This can mean that we are heading that way in the program. He later on will breathe upon the disciples here in the Gospel of John and say to them, receive the Holy Spirit. But they don't receive the Holy Spirit until the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. But yet, it's spoken of like that by Jesus, and in the same way here, I ascend to my Father. He's saying, this is the program. The next step is I am heading for that. Let the disciples know everything is still on course. We are still with the program. But notice this, what he calls them. But go to, now before this in the Gospels, he has called them servants. He has called them disciples. And in the last few days in the Gospel of John, he even calls them friends. But this is the first time that Jesus calls them brothers. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father and my God and your God. The significance of that, now that he is the resurrected Lord, he has done the work that actually brings us into the family of God. It doesn't make us equal with Jesus. Of course not. He is God in the flesh. He is incarnate God. He is alone the Lord of all and the Creator. But it brings us in some way into a family relationship so that we are blessed along. We are blessed along with him, and now the word he has, I ascend to my Father and your Father, my God and your God. And one of the things Jesus had talked about, and I think this is significant as far as this intimacy that, don't cling to me, I'm going to ascend. There's going to be a time, Mary, there's going to be a time, disciples, when you're going to have a special blessing. And in John 16:7, Jesus told the disciples, but I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. He's talking about his departure, which will not only be the death, burial, and resurrection, but will be the ascension. For if I do not go away, the helper, the one called alongside, speaking of the Holy Spirit, will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. It's really hard for us to understand how this is a better blessing, but Jesus himself says that it is, because while he's on earth in the physical body during his ministry, he can only be at one place at one time. Think of that, only at one place at one time. But now that he is the ascended Lord and that he is back in heaven, by his Holy Spirit whom he will give, this Holy Spirit will be given to all, and Christ through his Spirit is everywhere with all believers. That is, it's not just one. He is ministering amongst all of us. This is why Jesus is sending this word, this message to them, so that they know we are on the program, everything is on schedule, everything is fine. Well, this has all been told to Mary, so what does she do? She lets go of Jesus. And Mary came announcing to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. How do you think that went? And that he had said these things to her. Now, let me just tell you one more really beautiful thing about this. In that day, in the New Testament time, in Jewish courts, a woman's testimony was not valid. Only men could give testimony. Look what Jesus did. The first person that sees the risen Lord, for she is the first one in the record. When you look at the harmony of all the Gospels, the first one that sees the risen Lord and the first one that brings the news that the Lord is risen is a woman of shady background who had been indwelt by 7 demons and delivered by Jesus and who would be in no way fit by anyone in the community to look at and say, I'll listen to what she says, but that's who God chooses to bring the news of a resurrected Jesus to the disciples. Mary. I want to talk quickly on application for this, for what we walk away, and I do this in my messages. I talk about what do we walk away with on this, and let me tell you quickly, what do we walk away with this today? Well, the one thing is this, We need to realize that we have intimacy with the risen Lord through the Holy Spirit right now. Have you ever thought, if only I could have been there? Oh, I would have clung to Jesus. I would never have let go. Well, you're not there. You can't be there. So rather, what do we have? We have his wonderful program that, as he said to the disciples, when he goes away, he would send the Holy Spirit. And so that's what you and I have. And in the new covenant time that we live in, we're taught in the New Testament in Ephesians chapter 1, in him, Paul writes, speaking of Jesus, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, the moment you believed the gospel, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory. The moment that you put your faith in Christ, you are sealed with God's Holy Spirit of promise. God comes and indwells you. And that's what Paul points out to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 6 when he's encouraging them to be careful with what they do with their bodies, because do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you're not your own? This is the blessing you and I have today, and we overlook this, but this is incredible truth. John says it like this in the letter 1 John chapter 4, verse 13, "For by this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit." See, the Holy Spirit is giving testimony to believers. This is one of the ways that we know, that we understand. It's not the only way, but it is a way, the fellowship with Christ through his Spirit. So that we experience this. If you're a believer in Christ, you experience this, and you have and you will. In Romans chapter 8, verse 14 and 15, "For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you've received a spirit of adoption as sons by which we cry out." What does the Spirit within us cry out? The Holy Spirit, Abba, Father. So that being brought into the family that Jesus hints at there in the message that he gives Mary to go to my brethren, that you and I partake of through the Spirit today. And he goes on talking about the Holy Spirit and says this, "In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words." This is the ministry of the Holy Spirit in my life and your life today if you're a believer in Christ. We've got to understand that this is the presence of Christ with his people through the Holy Spirit. We don't get to see him physically right now. We don't get to cling to him and say, "We love you." But we get his Holy Spirit working to such a depth that he is praying. The Spirit of God is praying for you right now, interceding with groanings too deep for words. You've been there before in prayer. I've been in situations I don't know the next thing to say. I don't know how to pray. Praise God, he does. That ministry goes on because he knows us completely. So understand that right now we have this intimacy with the risen Savior through the Holy Spirit. But there's more to come. Isn't that good? Yeah, I know, I like it too. Paul will talk about this in 1 Corinthians 13. "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I also have been fully known." Paul talks in 1 Corinthians 13 about how we are currently going around partially blind, partially dumb, and the time's going to come where we see everything, we know everything. By the way, that's not going to be in this life. It's coming in the future. Jesus talks about this as he is preparing the disciples for his arrest and crucifixion, the whole departure. "In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Isn't that a great thought, that we are waiting for Jesus to come back and take us home? 1 John chapter 3. "See how great a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we would be called children of God. And such we are." For this reason, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him because we will see him just as he is. We are going to see the risen Lord. We are going to. He's coming back. This is what the next part of the program is. You see, there's intimacy in this whole relationship with Jesus. So in Revelation chapter 2, I love how it is he's writing here. He has this message to one of the seven churches. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, and remember, how do we overcome? Our faith. To him I will give some of the hidden manna. And then look what he says. And I will give him a white stone and a new name written on the stone, which no one knows but he who receives it. Now, I don't understand everything about that white stone with a name, a new name for us that's written and nobody knows it but us, but I know this, that speaks of intimacy. That speaks of one-on-one. That's not carbon copied. That's not produced in China. This is given directly by the hand of God to each believer. And we receive this stone with this name. And the picture is intimacy. I love it. I love that when you get to the last chapter of the Bible, then he showed me a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and in the middle of the street, and on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Do we need healing of the nations today? There will no longer be any curse. This is where the curse is completely done away with. It started in Genesis chapter 3. There will no longer be any curse, and the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his bondservants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. You talk about what's coming and what we yearn for, the best is yet to come. His name will be on my forehead. What does that mean? Listen, ask any child, any kid here will know when you have a toy and you write your name on it what that means. That's ownership. That says, this is mine. And we will have his name written on our forehead. We're his. We're his people. And look at the blessing. And there will no longer be any night. They will not have need of the light of a lamp or not light of the sun, because the Lord God will illumine them, and they will reign forever and ever. That's the final picture that you and I are going to be in one day. Complete, total intimacy. We will see him face to face. It won't be in prayer. It won't be through just the Holy Spirit's ministry. Because right now, though we have the Holy Spirit in us, yet the scripture affirms that right now, we walk by faith, not by sight. The Lord is certainly aware. But that's why what we come to at the end is this. Until that time that you and I get to experience the face-to-face that, oh, Mary had it for a short time, that moment. But that wasn't where Mary would get to live. Mary Magdalene didn't get to live the rest of her life clinging to Jesus in person. No, that's why Jesus says, Mary, this isn't yet the time. We're not at that point in the program yet. I've not yet ascended. There's some stuff to go on to give intimacy to you and me. This intimacy of creator and creation. Until then, keep, and this is where you and I are then, until then, keep living for the resurrected Lord. You see, this is exactly what Paul says. Through the Holy Spirit. Therefore, being always of good courage and knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. While we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. I just want to point out on this beautiful resurrection morning, as we celebrate the risen Lord, we're not home yet. We're not. Oh, we celebrate and we yearn and we look forward to, and oh, come Maranatha, Lord Jesus, we're ready. And I'm more ready every day. Just watch the news. Listen to the news. You'll be more ready all the time. But know this. While we're at home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are of good courage, I say, and prefer rather to be absent from the body and where? To be at home with the Lord. Everyone in this room has been in that time when you've been on a vacation that blew apart. And you're traveling back and you're having trouble, maybe whether it's the airline or maybe you're driving and the car breaks down or you're stuck somewhere in a traffic jam. Maybe you just had a really, really lengthy time, longer than you thought, and it wasn't nearly what you expected it was going to be, and it had a lot of hassle to it. And you just are exasperated and you say, whew, I cannot wait to be where? Home. I cannot wait to get home. Yeah. That's what our spirit should be saying to the risen Lord. I can't wait to be home. Because understand this, guys, we're not home yet. When we're home, here's the beautiful thing. We will get to cling to him. We will get to abide with him. We will get to see him face to face. We will be done with these sinful bodies. We will have new bodies. We will be in a place that has no sin. There's no longer any curse. And his name will be on our forehead. We belong to him. And that's where we go for eternity, reigning forever and ever. We're not home yet. But because there's a resurrected Lord who conquered death, that's where we're going. Jesus, I pray that you would help us to love you more for what you've done in making that intimate relationship available to each one in this room who trusts in you. I pray, God, that you would stir our hearts up to love you more and more, for you alone are worthy, Jesus. Amen and amen.
Go ahead and stand with us.
Yeah. Rejoiced as though heaven had lost, but then Jesus arose with our freedom.
Just one more song that we're going to do, and this is the reality of what the risen Jesus means for us, that we've been made free. The judge who could, by all rightful means, sentence us to death, right? He's our defense, and he has accepted the payment that was made for us. So.
The judge is my defense. I'm going free. Right.
Wow. That is exciting to serve a risen Savior, isn't it? Now, you know what's exciting, too, is to go out and serve a risen Savior. And that's what we now do. We go out into the world that knows nothing about him. Oh, they know some. They've heard. Some think they know. But I mean, so many people, Jesus is just, he's either a non-issue or he's a religious token or whatever. They do not understand the truth of the Word of God. We do. We have his Holy Spirit. We ought to go out into the world and take his truth to the world that is so devoid of truth. And when we do that, I don't think we need to go out and be apologetic about it, nor do I think we need to go out and try to come up with a creative way to maybe sort of hint to somebody. I think we ought to just share that there's a risen Savior. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. I was in Home Depot this week, and you know, I'm in there shopping for something, and this man, kind of a nice outfit, walks up next to me and says, "Hey, how you doing today?" I said, "I'm fine. I'm looking for whatever." "I'm fine. Do you find what you're looking for today?" "No, I just got here, but I'll find it." "Okay. So what sort of project are you working on?" Thinking, what's wrong with this guy? Said, "I'm looking at a plumbing thing, da 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 da." And then he goes, "Do you own your home?" I go, "Ah." Because we're selling air conditioner stuff, or no, solar. We have solar. We do solar power. Do you? It's like, "No," I said, "no thanks, not interested." "Well, why aren't you interested?" And suddenly we're in this, but I was thinking about that. A lot of times that's how we sort of try to come up and, you know, soft, so, "Hey, act interested in someone. Hey, how you doing? Having a nice day?" Well, I think that we have something so good in the risen Savior. The disciples went forth in the book of Acts and they proclaimed the resurrected Lord. Read about it in Acts chapter 4. They proclaimed the resurrected Lord. That's what you and I need to do. Go out and proclaim. Love the world, serve people, show love to them, but proclaim Jesus and the gospel, that you are saved by trusting in him alone. If there's anyone here that's not made that decision to put your trust in Jesus alone, I just implore you, you must do that. You've got to make that decision. You've got to put that, anchor in the, drive that peg in the ground on that one so that you know. And we'd be glad to help you with that. If you have no idea what that means, on the flyer that you got, there's an address to contact a pastor that you can type in or scan, but just reach out. We would love to take time and help you understand the gospel, but do not miss out on the opportunity. But church, go out and live a resurrected life, because Jesus brought us out of a tomb too, didn't he? Jesus, thank you for this day of worship. Thank you that you are the risen Lord. Thank you for all we have to celebrate. We are blessed, blessed, blessed as your people, and we go forth in your name. Fill us with your Spirit now. Might we do the works that you want us to do. Give us boldness to proclaim in this day. In your name, Jesus, amen.